See, if the verbal message is contradictory to our non-verbal cues, the recipient will believe or not. He will believe our communication or not. Generally, no. Because, as I said, it is 93%, it's our body language. So, body speaks the most. Generally, people will take that meaning only. Not what we verbally talk. So that much importance the body language has. Okay, now let us come to the features of body language then. So what is body language then? What is the features of body language? So when I say it is involuntary, I am saying it is a set of involuntary actions of our body parts, of all our body parts. That means it is not controlled by the mind. It is highly spontaneous. The gestures that we make, it comes very spontaneously, right? And when I say it is not only our head movement, I can't say only one body part. It is it involves all the movements, that is especially the limbs and also the head. It is highly involuntary in nature. And it does not have any grammar, as we have in verbal communication where we focus much on our grammar, whereas in non-verbal communication there is no such grammar. And this is very important, the broad interpretation, that is the meaning that we are sending to the recipient. Okay, they themselves will interpret the meaning in the way they want. So that is what we are going to see now. So then, why body language is highly important? Here again, I would like to give you one more empirical study. That is, I would like to talk about Professor Albert Mervyn. He is, he has done lot and lot of researches on non-verbal communication, and according to him, he has brought a lot of astonishing results. So his finding says that only 7% is what we talk. And 38% of our communication is based on our voice or the tone, and 55% is body language. So when I say 55%, what does that include? It includes the gestures, postures, movements, and expressions that a person uses to communicate with the other person. Now let us see the differences between the body language and sign language. Okay, there is a subtle difference. Both this language, they have a similarity. What similarity they have? What similarity they have? It is a, it's more, this type of communication is mainly through our body movements, right? But it has got a subtle difference. See, when I talk about body language, it is highly involuntary in nature and it is not controlled by the mind. Whereas sign language, it is highly voluntary in nature. It can be controlled by our mind. And you know, the words or the information that we usually use our hands or fingers in our sign language. And for body language, we do not have any grammar. But sign language, it is just like learning another language. It has got its own grammar systems. And you know, in body language, we communicate and we express the meaning by our face or the posture. Okay, how we feel, how we think at all. But in sign language, it is like the lip movements. Mostly the lip movements play a major role, right? Lip movements, then I can even say the finger, then palm movements, eye movements, or all these things are used to convey the information to the recipient. So by this we can understand there is a difference between the body language and the sign language. Now let us see what are the forms of non-verbal communication. By this everyone will know. I need not tell, but everyone will know. But let us once again review it. What are they? They are the eye contact, then facial expressions, and then gestures, then I can say the posture. Apart from that, you have the pitch of your voice, smell, even time aspect. Even that is also taken as a type of a non-verbal communication. It gives a kind of a meaning to the recipient. Okay, when I talk to you about the forms, I would just like to again talk to you in precisely, that is, I want to tell about the 7 aspect, that is body movements. When I talk to you about the body movements, we all know that is, it is involuntary in nature and it is not controlled by our mind, isn't it? So what kind of movements you can just say? It is the shaking of the head or the gestures that is coming so spontaneously and it cannot be controlled, right? When I talk to you about the posture, the way we sit, okay, it reveals lot of meaning to the recipient. It reveals a kind of, if the posture, say when we see the posture, we will be seeing there are types of postures also. So it will give the recipient its own meaning, like, okay, whether he is scared or whether he is open to, or whether he is friendly nature. So all this kind of meaning can be revealed to just by the posture. When I talk to you about the eye contact, yeah, you know that eyes are the windows of our soul, isn't it? So it has got many hidden non-verbal body signals, right? So when I talk to you about the paralanguage, it is the other aspect, that is, it is not what I'm talking to you, it is not about the speech. There are other aspects. What are they? They are the pitch, the tone of your voice. For example, if a person, you know, speaks very fastly, it has its own meaning. So the recipient may take either that person may not know about the subject, or he doesn't know what he is trying to convey. So when I talk to you about the closeness, okay, closeness, I am talking to you about, it is about the proximity. What is that? It determines the relationship. So how much relationship the person is having, it can be determined based on this particular aspect. And when I talk to you about the facial expressions, so this many would have encountered, like, you know, some, they would have asked you like, oh wow, today you are looking so happily, I think you are in a very good mood, wow, your eyes are looking very pretty. Or they may say like this also, what has happened, you are not well, you didn't sleep yesterday. All this kind of conversations we would have heard, right? So just, we did not talk to them verbally, but see how they are taking just by seeing the facial expressions of us. When I talk to you about the physiological changes, this one, supposing, this also I would like to give you one example. Supposing you're asking a person to present in a meeting, okay? Supposing if he shows a kind of palpitations, or if he sweats, we can understand from that the other person is nervous, right? So a small physiological change can give lot and lot of cues and meaning to the recipient. So that is why all these 7 aspects are very important. So let us see the forms of our body language. So first one is eye. As I said, eye is the window of our soul. So, moreover, I can say that eye contact also gives you a sign of confidence, right? And also, it can also show that whether the person is interested in the conversation or not. Apart from that, what we can say, if there is an absence of an eye contact, okay, this can also reveal a kind of meaning. What kind of meaning? either we can say that the person is not having interest, or there is a misunderstanding, right? So just by seeing the various directions of the eye movements of a person, no, we can explain, we can assess what is actually going on in his mind at this moment. So I would like to give you this pick a small example. Supposing if you are asking a person, okay, for example, you are saying, can you please talk about your school days, or can you share your childhood memories? Immediately we can assess, we can see the direction of the eye movement. No, it will move to the left corner for a fraction of a second. So this is called as visual memory. Same wise, if the eye movements, okay, if the eyeballs moves to the right corner, that means he is constructing a visual image. That means what? Supposing you are asking a person, can you imagine yourself in the costume of a doctor, right, or a lawyer? So in this case, he has to visually construct an image which he did not have early. So what will happen? The eyes will go move up to the right corner, and this is where we can say that he is constructing a visual image. So even the lies, no, we can say based on this particular movement, whether the person is really telling a fact or it is a lie. When I talk to you about the next one, like if the eyeballs go to the downside, or down means it is no associated with the feelings, and if it goes to the left, down to the left, okay, the eyes down to the left, can you see in the pic? It indicates a kind of a sensory impression that is being created. That means what? You are by all yourself, you are having a self talk within yourself. So that time your eyeballs will go to the left corner, down, that to the, down to the left corner. And supposing if it goes to the down and it's going to the right, then we can see that the person is remembering the sounds. For example, if I ask you, like, you know, how you feel when you run on the seashore, immediately what will happen? You will imagine the beach, and you will imagine the waves, and you will in your mind you will think about that particular sound, isn't it? So one more example I can say, that supposing if I ask you to imagine the sound of a speeding train, right? So the eye will actually go to the right side, right? So when I go, before going to the next, I would like to say that so some people may ask me this question, like, okay, with this, we can be sure that this is what is happening, this is what I have to take. Yes, we can actually go and stand in front of the mirror, and we can do a self-evaluation for ourselves and see. And one more thing I would like to say, instead of you just start observing the directions to which the eyeballs are moving, and please don't be stress to see where the eye it goes and rests. So that is not the work. The thing is, like, you are just noticing how the directions of your eye movements are going, and you are just trying to assess, and you are trying to evaluate yourself. As I told you that, you know, body language, it is something which is coming involuntary. So body language, we can say that it is there in almost all the conversation, all our normal conversation, but it has got a major role. Where it has got a major role? Supposing if you are being in an interview, or you are in a group discussions, or you are giving a meeting, okay? So there, what will happen? For example, if you take the interview, there what will happen? the interviewer will actually assess you. Okay, he will assess your body language. He will not give you a post mainly by whatever you are verbally saying. It is more the way you are the non-verbal cues or the non-verbal signals. That is based upon only he is going to give you the job. So in that, the most important one is the eye movements, right? So now you will be asking me a next question. Okay, now you told me about the eyes which is going moving up and also moving down. What about if the eyes goes to the straight side, that is to the left and to the right side? If it goes to the left, it is like, I'm just remembering my memory. From the memory, I am just trying to call up the incidents and I am just going to share about it. And if it goes to the right, then here, for example, we may have some favorite songs. For example, if somebody asks you to sing a song of the national anthem, or we can say that any of your favorite song, okay, immediately the eyes will go to the right side where you are trying to remember that song and you are going to say. So it is easy to remember that if it goes to the left side, it is the memory, and if it is the right, it is the thing that we are constructing an image and we are telling from that. Now we will come to the second posture, that is called a gesture. Okay, so same like eyes, it has also got its own meaning. Like it's very important, like how you sit, how you stand, how you use the hands and legs, okay, when you are talking to somebody, because all these kinds of movements, it actually reveals about your personality, because in body movements, the recipient may actually some hidden meanings are there, okay? It is not that what we actually trying to convey them. It is the, we are also sending other messages, like we are revealing our personality, we are revealing our attitudes, and also sometimes certain movements, it also indicates our emotions, right? Yeah. So now let us see the hand and arm gesture. So here in the pic you can see rubbing the palms. So what is that it indicates? It indicates a positive expectation. That means when we are delivering a good piece, a good news, okay, we will do this. Wow, I got a new job. This will come automatically. Okay. And one more example I can give you, like supposing you have come for the lunch and your mom has prepared a favorite food for you, okay, and it is kept on the table, and you are coming to have your lunch and you are in the table now, and when you are seeing that, immediately you say, wow, it's my favorite dish, thank you, so nice of it, so nice of you, mom. Immediately we will do this, right? And supposing if the hands, now, if you are rubbing the hands very slowly and the fingers are interlaced, okay, this means that there is doubt. You are indicating feelings of doubt, right? Now we are going to the hand and arm gestures only. We are going to see the second position. That is, can you see the pic? It is the gripping the hands, wrists or arms behind. So all this indicate, a kind of a confident and superior gesture. No, this, when you would have seen our HODs, principal, correct? Yeah. So the next one is steepling hands. Can you see in the pic? I need not tell. From the pic itself, we can say, yeah, it reveals a confident and superior attitude. So that means we can say, just by this gesture, we can say that the presenter, she knows about the subject well, and she knows that what is she is talking about. She is highly confident, and no, she also shows her superiority. And this is called as the clenching hands. What does this determine? What does this signifies? It is a kind of a self-restraint. That means I'm holding myself back. I'm having a negative reaction. And also it can be seen when people are highly excited or frustrated. Even then, that time also we can see this kind of a posture. Supposing if they are clenching their hands very tightly, okay, the more the tightest, it actually signals that they are in a very high negative attitude, or they are highly excited or highly tensed, right? So now let us come to the second one, hand to face gesture. Okay, so here can you all see the pic? It is the covering the mouth, touching the nose, rubbing the eye, and the neck scratch. Okay, all this indicate that the person has lot of doubt, or it can be lying. And one more thing, when I want to tell you that just only one aspect, if he is covering the mouth, based on that we can't say that no, the person is lying. So we need to understand the cluster of it, and then we have to tell. So that is why I gave in the beginning the body aspects, all the bodily movements, no, like I gave the seven, this thing you all remember, yes. So we need to remember the cluster, and then we need to assess the personality. Okay, now touching the ear, no, or the earlobe, this also we can see many people doing it. It is saying that okay, it's really boring, I don't want to listen anymore, I'm withdrawn. And also it also shows one more thing, like if a person wants to speak, okay, he will also do it very naturally. So we all know that all bodily movements are involuntary in nature. Yes, fingers in the mouth, it actually signifies, you know, a kind of an insecurity and wants reassurance. And also we do this when we are highly excited, or when we are waiting for something. Okay, what's going to happen? What's the next? Immediately we will keep our fingers in the mouth. Right. This one, hand supporting the head. This one many would have done. Like as a student, I can say, for example, if the class is very boring, we actually do this. And when there is... sometimes in the afternoon and all, and when we do not have any work, and sometimes there are times, right, where we get bored. Suppose the presentation is highly boring, also we do this, right? Yeah. Fingers or hand touching the chin, okay, or touching the cheeks. These are all called as the evaluation gesture or decision-making gesture. That is, when we are going to take a new decision, or you know, we'll be thinking, is this fine? Shall I take this decision? Is this will be apt? No? Shall I continue my studies? Is it okay? Shall I go to this university? Shall I take up this job or not? Shall I do this semester exam? So, when we are going to take a decision, we do this kind of a gesture. Now, head rubbing. This also many would have done, right? Head rubbing or the head slapping. Immediately we do it when we do a mistake. Oh my goodness, it's I have done a mistake. And also it indicates a kind of frustration when we meet. Hello?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am, you're audible. Yeah.
So it also indicates that the person, when he is in a frustration mood, that is when we do a mistake, no, what happens, like we sometimes need to rework on it, right? And that is something very frustrating and irritating. So this kind of gesture we can see in that time. Now, neck touching or stroking. Okay, this also many of us would have done, like when we are highly preoccupied and we are highly stressed, no, we can understand that we are in the we are stressed and tensed. And same way, we can also assess the other person. Assess that the other person is highly stressed. Now we will go to arm and leg gesture. Yeah, can you see the pic? The folded arms, crossed legs, and the ankle lock. All this indicates a kind of a negative and defensive attitude, right? It also says displeasure, stubborn nature, and the person is having a high a negative attitude or emotion. And also it signifies one more thing, no? When we are kind of scared or nervous, also we can see this kind of a posture, right? Now we will go to the reading gesture. See, I always said that it is very important to go by the cluster, context, and the culture. Okay, while assessing the body language, it is very important to go by all these three. So, for example, can you see in the pic the crossed arms and the crossed legs with the head down? No, it all these three, it is a cluster. And it shows a kind of a defensive or a negative attitude. Now, how to read the body language? Can you see this? Can you see the seventh in the pic? Yeah, it is study the eyes, gaze at the face, pay attention to proximity, see if the other person is mirroring you. What does that mean, mirroring? If the other person does the same thing like you, that means what is that it signifies? It signifies that the other person likes you. He is interested talking to you, right? So that also it's very important body language. And another thing is we have to observe the head movement. What kind of movement that is showing, okay? And we need to give importance to the hand signals, like how is his hands and whether it is crossed or whether it is open, because it signifies its own meanings, right? So by this time, everyone will know about the meaning of our body language, right? So then even the arms, that also we should we should try to observe and examine it. So all these things, by this, we can read the body language of the other person. Now, we need to remember this similarity. I said that it is very important to go by the cluster, then culture, and the context. So here, in many of the countries, okay, this kind of gesture, it is used for when we say it's okay, wow, superb. Okay, so generally I can take this as an okay symbol, right? Yes, it's done. Okay. And another one more this thing we can easily remember, that is when we nod our head like this, it is yes, I'm saying an yes. And when I nod my head like this, I'm saying a no. So this is also there in all, universally in almost all the countries. So same wise, no, we need to remember all these things. In some countries, there are a reverse practice also. So we need to understand their culture and then we have to assess the body language. Now let us see the facial expressions. Yeah, you all will agree that face have everything to do, right? And it conveys a strong message, actually tells you the other person about your story. No, that emotions that we display, what kind of emotions? Happy, sad, fear, angry, surprised, and also disgusted. Sometimes also we can, the face also can reveal a kind of a mixed emotions, right? Yeah. when we are surprised, okay, or when the other person is surprised, we can just see the upper eyelids, the eyebrows rise and the jaws open. Wow, right? And when I'm angry, so what happens here? My lower and the upper eyelids and the eyebrows tighten. No, I used to, I shrink my eyes and I just look in that kind of face. And when I say sadness, no, what happens? The eyelids actually droop. No, and the eyebrows rise. Can you see in the second pic? Yeah. When I say happiness, yeah, immediately our mouth will lift with a smile, right? And here I would like to say about another thing also, happiness. And also I want to talk to you about the smile. Smile is very, very important in the body language, because smile also, it kind of gives a signal that the other person is highly interested and he is highly friendly. See, there is two types of smile. That is called as the real smile, and another one is called as the fake smile. So how to understand, how to assess that? Supposing if it is a real smile, we can see there will be wrinkles, okay? Wrinkles around the corner of the eyes, and we can see the mouth and the jaws here. It will all get contracted. Okay, but if it is a fake smile, okay, it will involve only the lip. Okay, now we will see about the fear. When I talk to you about the fear, what happens? The eyes will actually open widely, and also the upper lids also will rise. Okay, understood? Shall I go to the next? Yeah, now we will come to the posture. So as in the pic, we can understand what is a good posture is. Because standing straight, balanced, it gives a kind of an upright posture. So that is actually a very good posture. Yeah. So posture can also convey a lot of information about the person, like how he is feeling. And also it gives the other person about that his personality traits, and also like it also signifies whether the person is confident, whether he is open, or whether he is a submissive. So there are two kinds of posture. Can you see in the pic? They are open posture and the other one is the closed posture. So what is open posture? What is open posture? Can you see? It involves the keeping the trunk of the body open and exposed. So it indicates a kind of a friendliness, openness and willingness, right? And what is closed posture? It involves hiding the trunk of the body. Can you see in the pic, the lady, you know, she hides the trunk of the body and she hunches forward and keep the arms and legs also crossed, right? So, yeah. Now let us see the last one, that is, in order to have an healthy body language, or we can say this as tips to enhance our body language, we can do all these things. Like we can always have eye contact. So that is very, very important. The eye contact, we should maintain our eye contact, but at the same time, we should not stare at the person, right? So the second one is, do not cross your arms. This posture, we know that it gives a kind of a withdrawn posture or a defensive posture or a negative posture, right? Nod your head. That means it actually indicates the other person is interested. Yes, I'm interested in the conversation. So it kind of gives a signal. Yes, she is interested in listening to my conversation. And relax your shoulders. That is very important. If the shoulders are not relaxed, no, it will kind of give what kind of, it signifies what kind of feeling. It actually signifies there is a kind of a tensed kind of a feeling, right? So very importantly, good posture. The posture should be open like this. It should be an open posture. It should be a friendliness posture, right? So with this, we can understand more about our body language. And at the end, I want to tell you one more thing, that in order to develop our interpersonal skills, so it is very important to do a self-evaluation and see ourselves. Now we can do a mirroring practice, and now we can enhance our interpersonal skills. So at the end, from this we can understand the importance of the body movements, expressions, and the readings. Okay, because it's all very important to have a healthy communication and to improve our interpersonal skills in both in our personal as in as well as in our professional lives. Okay, yeah. Now it's over to you now. Thank you. Hello.
Thank you, ma'am, for the very informative session we had. We really enjoyed it, and it was like too much of information with giving us the, a whole understanding of how the whole understanding of body movements and how it is very important for us to have a healthy thing. So thank you so much for the information you have provided us today.
Thank you.
So if any of you have any questions regarding ma'am's session, you can feel free to kind of either unmute yourself and ask them one by one, or you can either put it down in the chat. So ma'am would be really kind enough to answer all of your questions. I think, ma'am, some of them had issues with being unable to see the PPTs. I think that was one concern. I'm not sure if it was a network concern, but maybe everyone else were able to see the PPTs. So.
Okay. Okay. Sometimes no network issues. Yeah, I can understand.
Yeah.
So now you can share your understandings, Sonia.
Oh, ma'am, am I on?
Yeah.
Audible. We have one
yes.
question.
Okay.
How do we? Yeah. So the question is, how do we learn anger, or maybe I think how do we learn to identify anger for early beginning of life?
Yeah, it is a very beautiful question. So it's very important that when we are angry also, it is very important that we should not hold our anger. We should try to vent out our anger. But only thing is, we have to do it in a very positive way. So we can actually start doing this by having a journal with us. Okay, what makes us anger? Why I am angry? Why I am getting angry? So we can record our this thing, events, and we can also observe what I am doing in that time. So where I am reacting and where I am responding. So if we have a journal and if we practice it for a couple of, say, 21 days, we can try to figure out where we are going wrong, and we can enhance that particular thing, right? Hope I have answered your question.
Ma'am, we have another question. How do we manage anger of CWSNS in a classroom situation?
Yeah, that is a beautiful question. No, like it's very important. Like where that is where I am saying you. Like it is where we have to be. No, reacting. Where we have to give be reactive, and where we have to respond. So that is where it's where no everything plays. So we need to understand what makes us angry. First, we should know. For that, we have to have a observation of ourselves. So unless and until I am ready to go for that particular change, and we have to rewire our own hidden beliefs, you know, only then we can see a improvement. And then we should be openness for a change. We should take that kind of a responsibility. Yes, yeah. Only then we can see a positive change. So what I always suggest is, like, no, I suggest all my clients to have a journaling practice. That is very important. You can call it as a journal writing, or you can call it as a diary writing also. If it is not, no, you can take for either any one particular behavior, or you can take it for the entire one day, and you can just see what is the difference that you are seeing it. But all those things involves a lot of consistency and regularity. Unless and until I do it for a couple of days, that is at least say 21 days non-stop without giving a break. It's not like Saturday, Sunday, okay, I have a break. No, all 7 days you need to work, right? Only then you can see the difference. The others will actually tell you there is a difference in with you. Maybe you will not be knowing, the others will tell. Right, and I also want to say one more thing. Like there are a lot of people who says that, you know, I'm a very short tempered girl. I say, why you want to bring that kind of a quality? Even the parents, they will say, you know, my son, no, he will get very angry, and so when you bring that, or when you create that kind of a quality, what happens is that you are giving a lot of energy to that particular activity. Particular thing, particular quality, you are bringing it. So this thing. So what happens is the brain will start, oh, this one they like it. So let me be like this itself. You got it. So one way is like we should be ready to bring that kind of a change. We need to rewire ourselves. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. So we do have one more question. Some people avoid eating when they are angry or sad. Which category does that belong to? Is it reacting or responding?
It actually, it all depends upon their own individuality. We can't say that it is reacting or responding. It's all, we can't say like that. Some people, when we are highly angry, we used to skip our food. If you are stressed also, we used to do that. So that is, instead we have to think like how to manage myself, how to be healthy. See, each one of us have born in this world to become happy, to be happy and satisfied in their lives. So we need to think in that perspective. And also to have a healthy lifestyle, it is very important, like, to maintain a very good food habits. Lifestyle is very important to avoid long-term chronic illness.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you.
We just have one last question.
Sure.
Is food and drink related to developing anger?
We can't say this, because I don't believe in all those things. Yes, it also adds, like even we say, no, in the colors and all, no, it actually creates a kind of an hormonal reaction within ourselves. So, but I can't give this one as 100% because there is not much of empirical studies also. And as I said, it's all based upon the individuality only. So we need to see it and do it at it is like an early intervention, no? And we have to start learning, and we have to rewire ourselves. That is, we have to change the blueprint. So parents has to really work on all these aspects. Yeah.
Absolutely. Ma'am, so we just have one last question.
Yeah.
Mr. Ram Narayan wants you to kind of throw a little light on micro expressions.
Micro expressions. Actually, it is also a beautiful concept. And first, what I would like to say is it's very important to understand the first level. Okay. First, we need to understand our body as understand our body language, and then we can go into the next one. So this is what I feel now.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you so much for that, ma'am. I think we're all done with the questions, and thank you so much for your time.
Can you hear me?
Talking. Sorry, I think Mr. Yuvraj is talking. Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, Yuvraj.
You're audible.
Actually, I wanted to ask you. You mentioned something about the lifestyle changes.
Yeah.
So you can just share some.
Yeah, it's very what important. Kind of? Like, yeah, sure, Yuvraj. I will definitely do it. Like, no. Nowadays we can see it is highly a digital world, right? And a lot of people, and it's a pandemic situation, or you know, you take it for example, children. We do a lot of online education. Okay, I get a lot of calls. Like many of the parents have this problem when the children sit for their studies. Their discipline is somewhat get distorted. Okay, they don't. Timing, sleeping time, and everything is changes. It's not like how they before they used to go to school. For example, say at 7:30 means I will get up at 6 o'clock. It's not like that now, because nowadays the days are longer. Okay, that night 12 o'clock, 12:31, their kids also sleep. So what happens is because of that the discipline issues are there, and a lot of kids have problem in doing the homework or sitting in front of the laptop, and this thing also affects the eye also a lot, right? So the food habits, you know, what happens when they have that this thing, like when they are in the class, in the online education, and if I put in the mute and if I switch off the video, I will also eat that time itself. So what happens, it's I'm sure teaching my kid, what I'm teaching them, that no, we can be like this, it's okay. It's okay to be like that. But it's not like that. We have to give that importance. So small things only, you know, kids learn by seeing us. They observe us. Yeah, for them, we are the heroes and heroines, right? So they observe us, and then only they, so everything, no, it starts right from the beginning, like the time we get up to the time we sleep, what are the things that we do. And many of us, I've seen this also, like a lot of people used to watch TV and they used to have their food. They don't know what they are eating also. Correct?
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
So that is another issue. And the third thing is, nowadays Swiggy is there. Okay, any kind of Zomato and all those things are there. So actually, a 5 year kid also knows, like he used to bring the phone and he'll say, I just want to order. Today I'm not going to have a home food.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately what happens? Parents know. Initially they will say, wow, my kid knows everything. He knows to operate the mobile. 5 years, okay, you will encourage. But when it comes to 14 years, what you will do? You'll say, oh, man, it's really fedding. No? Every time he's only in the mobile, he's always playing like this. I don't know, the two thumbs has really, it's actually misplaced. No? And he's taking trip. So that is what I said. It's very important to see all those things, no? Correct it from in the beginning itself. So it is easier. The life will get easier. So only thing is, we all make the life complicated. Life is highly simple and it is to be happy. So, we have to think in that aspect, and we have to start changing ourselves. So that is why I said, Yuvraj, it is very important to change the lifestyle.
And actually, I wanted to know something about the sleep pattern, how it should be.
Good. Sleep pattern, as I said, many people have this... what you say, insomnia, like they used to say that I'm not getting sleep. First thing is, when you say I'm not getting sleep, that itself you are saying yes, you will not get sleep, because that is your thought.
Okay.
Okay, how much ever I go and take the sleeping pill, it's not going to work for me. I'm going to be getting addicted to it, right? So first you change your thought, change your blue patterns. Say that, yeah, I am healthy, I am going to sleep well. I am sleeping well. So first the thought pattern has to be changed. Secondly, it's very important to maintain a diary, sleep diary.
Okay.
Here you record it, like, okay, today I slept from this, have a routine, like, for example, if you sleep at 10, no matter what, I will get up at 5 o'clock. I will sleep, I may not sleep, it's okay, fine, but I will get up at 5 o'clock. Fix a biological clock inside yourself and maintain it and right. Start recording it. Once you write it, now I always say to write it, either it can be in the notebook or it can be, you can also have a journal, you can also do a lot of, nowadays a lot of journals have come, right? You can also do that, or you can, when you are having time, you can also sit with that kind of a craft and you can do a lot of doodling activities, make yourself relaxed. That is very important. To have a sleep, you should be relaxed. If you watch a serial, or for example, if you watch a serial, or if you watch, nowadays this Amazon Prime is there, Netflix is there, okay? And I get only that time. So first, stop that. Do not watch serials or movies right before sleeping. At least give 1 hour of gap. At the same time, the eating patterns has to be changed. So you have to have a particular time. And at least you should have a minimum of 2 hours of time before it has, the food has to get digested, right? So that is very important.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It means a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yuvraj, for that question. And thank you so much, ma'am, for giving us a detailed explanation of everything. And with this, we'd like to just, tell you a big thank you for collaborating with us. We're just starting off, and it's really such a big honor to have, you know, someone like you and your caliber kind of, you know, collaborate with us. So thank you so much for making this happen. And fill the feedback form, you guys, and let us know if you have any other queries and all of that. And you can get in touch with ma'am. You can, email her as well. So sure. If there's any other questions, anything else, you guys can feel free to leave the meeting. The event is officially over now. So thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am, sorry, one last thing. We would really request you to share your email address.
Yeah, sure.
On the chat. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah, one second.